Thanks for the invitation. I'm really honored. I'm a little bit surprised as well how many people nowadays have an interest in a topic like food systems. That was not the case 10 years ago, I can tell you. And also, I hope that this presentation will help you a little bit better understand what's the difference between, let's say, thinking in food security and thinking about food systems. I believe that that is really a different piece of cake, and it is also asked for different qualities. I'm an emeritus professor, so I am retired, but still very busy. One of the engagement is with the Netherlands Food Partnership in the Supervisory Board. And my major work is now with the International Food Policy Research Institute on a program called Agriculture for Nutrition and Health. And that's why I learn a lot in practice. So I have a program. I'm a little bit a philosopher about how food systems analysis can and should be done. And I prepared a small program. I will talk about 30 minutes, and I hope then we have some time for discussion. I hope that at the end of the day, you understand a little bit, first of all, why we make so many mistakes in food policies. And that's why I asked for the three initial statements, because all of them are more untrue than true. By the way, you had more or less similar scores as the employees of the Dutch embassies. So there is not a big difference there. But I will try to show you that it is very good to learn from mistakes, and we make many mistakes in food policy. Secondly, I hope that you at the end of the day also are a little bit more sensitized about why is it really relevant to use food systems approaches, that it is different from earlier approaches, and it might also bring you to different ideas on solutions. And then at the end, I will try to give you some practical principles. What does a food system program mean if you have to design it? So that gives a couple of points, aspects I want to share with you. I will start to give a little bit of background about what are the current challenges, then go back to those mistakes and fallacies, and then try to enlighten you a little bit how could you do on yourself food systems analysis, and then give some practical examples of game changers or leverage points that are useful. Now, if you are very busy, you can just go away with the takeaways, or if you don't like them, you can do that as well. I hope that at the very end of the day, you have 5 points in your mind. First of all, that poor people, that they are very much dependent on affordable and safe food, of course, also on healthy food. But most poor people are buyers of food, so they purchase it on the market. Even many smallholder producers at the very end buy most of the other food that they don't produce themselves. So food prices and affordability is really a key issue nowadays. Secondly, that all the different aspects of malnutrition, I will come to that in a minute, but stunting and wasting and overweight, etc., they all might provocate us to invest in better diets, not only just to eat good, but to reduce your potential health costs. And the cost of healthcare and the loss of lives is substantially related to the diets that people eat. So in fact, we become a little bit more doctors than agronomists after this thinking. Then the third one, if you want to change food systems to support the transition, you cannot start just at one level. You need multiple leverage goals. You have to bring people together. You can't do it on your own. The fourth one, if you bring in scale, if you want to make it grow, start small, but also do some and engage in experiments, because there is no one size fits all and no clear good solutions. You should learn it yourself in your own practice. And finally, perhaps the most important one, food governance, so what's around the production and consumption of food, is very much influential in the final decision. And the three elements related to that are empowerment, particularly women empowerment, gender, the innovations of the private sector, sometimes also public sector, and the fact that you need, let's say, to have different stakeholders engaged in what we call co-creation. So these are the main messages. Now, a lot of things happened in the last 25 years in terms of food and nutrition, but we are increasingly worried, and I will try to explain you why. First of all, if you look at the trends in terms of poverty, it really goes relatively well. No, it has been declining from about a third of the world population to a little bit more than 10%. But this decline has not been as strong in the area of stunting and child nutrition, stunting and wasting. It is decreasing, but not as fast as we would like to see, and substantially less faster than poverty. Also, undernourishment is declining, but not in the rate we would like to expect, and still far away from SDG 2, where we have promised ourselves to get it out of the world in 2030. And then finally, there is also an upward trend in terms of the increase of people that suffer from overweight and obesity. That's increasing very fastly. And there are now several developing countries or low and middle income countries where more people, poor people, die due to obesitas and overweight than due to undernutrition. So the panorama is shifting. And what we learn from those figures are two things. First of all, as you have also seen in the statement, poverty reduction does not lead directly, it contributes, but it does not directly lead to better nutrition. It's necessary, but not a sufficient condition. And for the agronomist amongst you, if you produce more food, it doesn't mean automatically that there is less hunger. There is no one-to-one relationship. They are important and related, but not directly related. Now, we are very much concerned internationally about the trends in terms of food and nutrition. We see increasing hunger since the last 3-4 years, the left-hand graph of the FAO. It has been increasing again after many years of decline to close to 900 million people. Then there is a calculation that if you want to eat a healthy diet, let's say that more than 3 billion people in the world don't have the resources to do so. And if they do so, let's say they have to spend 70-80% of their household income only on food. And as you can understand, that's not possible because also other commodities have to be purchased. And thirdly, we are all now living still in COVID, and COVID has substantially increased poverty in rural areas, but particularly in urban areas where most people have to buy food. And so there is a big concern, and we should all be worried, in fact. And it goes even further because it's not only food and nutrition, but also the environmental externalities. Food systems cause high emissions and are responsible for part of the climate change, and also have a negative effect on biodiversity at the moment. So there is a good reason also from the sustainability viewpoint to invest. Now, finally, let's say if we talk about hunger and malnutrition, the problem, as I showed you before, is more complex than in the past. It's not only stunting and wasting, but increasingly also what we call micronutrient deficiency, vitamin A, iron and zinc, for instance, and also overweight. And as you see, many of those problems coexist in different countries at the same time. And people believe even that they are mutually related. So if you have to face stunting and wasting in your early years, you are far more vulnerable for overweight in your adolescent period. Now let's go to this discussion about why we make so many mistakes. And I will highlight you three mistakes which we find very frequently. The first one is the price paradox. And that was statement number one. Higher prices, people believe, will incentivize farmers to produce more food and eventually leads to a higher and a better food and nutrition security, if everything goes in that linear direction. In fact, that's not how it goes in practice. If prices of food increase, more farmers might want to engage in leisure activities or in off-farm work. They do not intensify the labor in food production. So there is a contradictory outcome, and this has been proven in many countries. I worked in Nicaragua, I've seen that, but also in Zimbabwe and some other African countries. The higher prices could eventually also lead to lower food production, and so to lower food and nutrition security. And that's because we many times wrongly look at smallholders only as producers, but they're also consumers. They buy food, so a higher food price is negative if they have to buy food, and they also have a preference for leisure. So that relationship is not a one-to-one relationship. The second mistake is a mistake that we call the adoption paradox. That is your statement number two. So if you give credit and input subsidies, we usually expect that farmers will adopt more technologies, better technologies, and that might improve the sustainability and the productivity. But that's only one part of the story. if credit is provided, it is only used by farmers if they if the technologies are not too risky. So adoption only takes place if at the same time risk is reduced. If not, you have a lot of resistance to change. In fact, there is a large literature on it. So if there is resistance to change, resilience of the system does not improve at all. And the only way to overcome such a dilemma is to invest not only in credit and input, but also in approaches that reduce the risk, for instance, in insurance frameworks, etc. Now, the third mistake, and the last one for now, is, let's say, the idea that if you invest in more labor use in food production, that will increase your availability of food. And at the very end, that will lead to better nutrition. So that's the production-nutrition linkage. That supposes, in fact, one particular thing, that is that if you want to intensify labor, that there is labor available at the farmhouse. And most of the labor is female labor, sometimes even child labor. So if the gender division of labor limits the substitution of labor for males to females, and also when females don't feel encouraged to do such work, at the very end, it might end up with higher malnutrition instead of lower malnutrition. So gender and gender equality is one of the key leverage points, I can already say, for improving food and nutrition security. Yeah, that's one of the few things we are very certain about. Now, why do we make all those mistakes? There are three reasons for that. One is people, farmers, consumers, etc., they don't have one single objective. They have multiple objectives. They look for income, but also low risk. They want nutrition, but also resilience. And so they have to deal with what we call trade-offs. Sometimes they gain, sometimes they lose, and it goes together. So they have to bargain among them. The second reason is that people, particularly poor people, have limited resources. Yeah? So any change in technology, in nutrition, is costly and is risky. And they will not be willing to do so if they are not very sure about the more positive outcomes. And we have to assure them from that. And finally, if people livelihood, they depend not only on their resources, but also on how they are related to other stakeholders. So their relationship with other farmers, between men and women, their relationship with policymakers. So food and nutrition security, you can't guarantee on your own. You need to solve it together with others. Now we go a little bit to this food system thinking, and I've already seen in the chat, there is a lot of confusion about it. It is really different from food security in many aspects. Here you see the three paradigms that have been shifting from the 1916-18, where everybody was focusing on more food production. So there were lots of investment in having better seeds for yield increase, to get better sustainable technologies for food production, guaranteeing farmers tenure security. That was all very helpful, but it was particularly helpful to increase the production. Some 20 years ago, beginning of this century, people started to talk not about food production, but on food and nutrition security. So they also looked at the outcome of nutrition and diets, and then the diversification of crops in the farm became important. Also training of labor for work off farm, and how the linkages with markets, the produce they sell and the produce they buy, because nobody is independent. And then, let's say, about 8 to 10 years ago, this food systems paradigm became very popular and still is very popular. And it goes even further. It looks at the issues we mentioned before. It looks at risk management. It looks at the role of gender empowerment. It looks at stakeholder cooperation. So basically, it tries to not only change technical relationships in the food production and consumption system, but also it changes attitudes. And it changes behavior. And I tell you, that's even more difficult than just a technology change. Now, for food systems analysis, the higher level panel of experts of the FAO has developed this schedule, which looks very complex, but it is not in practice. On the top, you see a couple of what I call exogenous factors. We can't influence them, but they are very important. What technologies are available? What's the political system? How is urbanization growing? So for policy, short-run policies, you have to consider them as external exogenous drivers. where the really food systems interaction take place is at the bottom between the different food systems components, the production side, the distribution side, and the consumption side. The three blocks you see over there, and we call them food systems components, and we can also put them in a very simple interactive framework, production, consumption, and food environment. And then finally, and that makes it complex, we look at different outcomes, not only diets and nutrition or poverty, but we also look at outcomes in terms of environmental externalities and the inclusive livelihoods that farmers and consumers can build. So this relationship, particularly between how production consumption are linked and what does it deliver, is the core item of food system. Now, food system transformation is not the only transformation that takes place. It is a big one. It means that, let's say, people spend less of their household income on food. And if they spend more, they spend it basically on not on basic foods and fruit and vegetables, but on ultra-processed foods, usually also imported foods. So that is what we call the diet transition. But there is also a transition in many places of the world, particularly in West Africa, that the smaller farms become smaller and smaller, and that middle-sized farms, that they produce most of the market. And the third transition is in the value chain, sometimes called the supermarket revolution. A large part of the value added that is produced in agriculture just end up with the producer, but in between, in the midstream. So a lot of things are changing at the same time, and that increases our complexity. And then I have two figures that might inspire you. If you look at, you need a little bit of new imagination to look at food systems beyond food security. What we used to do in the past is this type of analysis, just causality. You start somewhere and then it gives a kind of linear response reaction. Now, what we have to deal nowadays is more, let's say, an interactive framework, where people and agents are interacting in different areas, they influence each other, and you can understand it's not as easy to find good solutions in the type of schedule as you see on the right. Now we go a little bit more to the practical side, and you might be most interested in that part. How to improve food systems. Now, first of all, we are not looking for just simple fixes on a problem that needs one solution. You have to look for solutions that are sustainable in the long run as well. And usually those solutions are found somewhere else than where the problem is. So it is not just repairing it where it is. You have to look at solutions that go beyond the original problem. And those solutions are not simple solutions, technologies, but they also include economic changes and behavioral changes. So that's quite a lot. Secondly, you need to understand a little bit how change happens. I'm not an expert in that, this is not a uniform process. It's different in all different places. Usually it starts with small steps and then it is scaled towards higher levels. But it is, let's say, not a single push and pull process. And then finally, as I said before, it's all about people. So how do people respond? So what we try to influence is the behavior of people. Now, just four principles that might be useful before I show some practical examples. I will just do it very briefly because it is all on the sheets. The first principle is that if you want to change food systems, you have to work on different sides. You cannot only work on production or consumption. You have to do it simultaneously. You also have to consider what happens outside the farm or farm employment, etc. That might be a big trigger for better nutrition, not only farm production. And in value chains, we usually look at different levels, both the consumer and the producer part, but increasingly the midstream is considered the dynamic part of the supply chain. Now, the second principle is that you need linkage. You need feedback between people. So you have to look at what happens if more vegetables are produced, what happens with the market price of vegetables. It might go down if everybody is engaged. And that is not a positive response. You're also looking for spillovers to other households. So if a few households start, that others become engaged as well. And finally, let's say it's very important to look at what happens within the household, between males and females, and also with children, how food finally ends up in nourishment and nutrition. The third principle is that you can do it on your own and that you need to engage, let's say, many people in what we call collective action. In fact, that is also the principle of the Netherlands Food Partnership. And therefore, many, sometimes strange stakeholders have to work together and you have to engage them. Not only food producers, also water companies and transport companies. And then you have to bargain with them because it is not, they will not automatically engage. You have to try to get them into your activity. And then finally, as I said, you have to work from both sides. You need to combine what we call hardware technologies, better technologies, software, which is the better management capacity, and the organizational part, how to bring people together. Now, I will, just as an illustration and to finish, give you a few ideas and feelings on what are really game changers. That's now the main approach for the UN Food Systems Summit, to identify game changers. How could game changers in food systems work? Just very briefly, in Nigeria, the tomato production from the north has to be transported to Lagos, that's about 1,000 kilometers, and much of the tomatoes are lost, post-harvest losses. So people started to look for crates to bring them in a better shape to the capital city. And of course, that was very successful, but the final result was that supermarkets had less loss and gained, and they had to transfer part of this value added back to the farmers to put the farmers and to enable the farmers to put the tomatoes in crates. And the crates had to be returned from the capital city to the production area. So what turned to be the game changer was the return system for crates. So that was paid by the supermarkets, and then farmers got also part of the revenues that were generated at the very end of the value. In Myanmar, we worked on dietary diversity. That is a very important issue for improving nutrition. Many people believe that it has to do with more different production at the farm. But what proved to be very effective was engaging in off-farm employment, in labor income. And with that labor income, they could buy different types of food. So it's not always on the farm that it happens. And in Vietnam, the school meals, a very influential program. We always believe that it is to engage, to keep people at school, children at school, and to guarantee their higher performance at school. But the most important effect at the very end is if parents take over the type of food that is used in the school meals and change their own dietary habits, that spillover gives sustainable. So finally, game changers at policy level, because also the policymakers can do a lot in improving food system performance. Very influential in parts of Latin America are the warning labels that say that the produce has too much sugar or too much fat. And we always believe that that has an influence on consumer choices, but that's not so important. It was far more important that the industry didn't want to have such negative labels on the produce and started themselves to modify the formulas of the products. Also in Africa, fermented foods is a very well-known example where the quality of food can be improved by through fermentation, but also at the same time, you get a lot of female entrepreneurship involved. And so you have a larger shelf life of product, but also a higher dietary content. And then let's say in the behavioral side, what we call nudging. So the fact that you are not, so you are creating in a way social norms that people are eating more fruits and vegetables, for instance, and that you make that like the easy solution and that, let's say, unhealthy foods become a little bit more difficult to acquire, even if they are. So there is a lot to do for you. And that's my final sheet. In different areas. First of all, I hope that you will understand now that you need to combine the changes in technology and changes in behavior. I hope that you also understand that the horizontal cooperation is important, but perhaps even more important, vertical cooperation between different players. That you can't do it on your own, you need individual solutions and collective response. And then finally, dealing with those trade-offs, what we are looking for is how to get solutions that help simultaneously to improve nutrition and climate or that reduce poverty and malnutrition. Now, you are the new generation, so I'm totally confident that you will be able to do so.